Hello everyone, it's Matt here, and welcome to a video about the Santa Fe diesel unit I've been building. Now, many of you have already probably seen this from the previous update videos for this as part of the collection series, but this is taking it and going off at an angle and really going to town on it. So the first thing is that everything you've seen in this video is actually available on mock pages. So there'll be a link to that in the description, so that you yourself can actually build this exact same model. The same LDD file I used to actually build the model and design the model is in there. Any changes I've had to make to my model to the LDD one are there. The LDD one still needs a bit of tidying up and cleaning up because there's like some few clips in a few places which shouldn't be there. Some of the pieces need to be updated to slightly reduce the part count and do other bits and pieces. But other than that, the LDD file is exactly the same as what I'm going to show you in the next couple of minutes. So obviously, the original ambition of this project was just to rebuild set 1000Z, you know, the Santa Fe unit. However, being someone who prefers realism, I sort of went, as nice as that set is, it's not to scale. So the first thing was just to lengthen it, space everything out a bit more, and then eventually that worked into adding a bit more detail, so I could add some filler caps. The underframe, for example, could be re-engineered, so there could actually be the actual fuel fillers as well, by using an upturned headlight brick to get that nice red surround, then using a new light blue scrape 1x1 round tile to actually just fill up to make the hub cap or the cap for that. So obviously those were very nice designs. Obviously I had to redesign the new chassis just using two layers of plates, and then I'd sort of finished the loco, and so I went in the design, so I went, that's very nice, and I started building the real one, and I sort of thought to myself, but normally you wouldn't just have an A unit on its own. You'd either have an AB unit, which was fairly common, or an ABA or an ABBA, or possibly even an AA. So it's essentially just a double-ended locomotive. Now, a bit of the background about the F units is that as a single individual unit, they generally speaking weren't that powerful, especially the sort of ones the Lego sets set depicts. It's supposed to be, some people are a bit sort of like, well, what's expected? I think the general consensus across many pages is that it represents an F3 style of F unit. So obviously, you know, there's that to the side where it's based on that design, but there is a few elements from a few other things as well. But as a locon itself, an individual unit is not that powerful. And bear in mind, these diesels were supposed to be the ushering in of a new era to replace steam traction. Now, steam traction, for the same weight as these diesels, was actually more powerful. So they sort of went, well, we've got this A unit, and as powerful as it is, we need something else. So what they did was they came up with the B unit. So obviously, the B unit differs from the A unit in that it doesn't have a cab, it doesn't have any other control gear or anything else. It is literally a slave to the A unit. So that, for example, if you have an A unit and an A unit isn't powerful, you get a B unit or a couple of B units, and they will then rely on the controls of the A unit to actually control them, to, you know, accelerate, to brake, to change direction, that sort of thing. So that is a very easy way of just adding more power, is just to add in a couple of B units. The other thing is, of course, is that the B units also enabled cross connectivity. So obviously I've said you could add one or a couple of B units to the A unit. The flip side could be true, and that you could also have a A-B-A combination. So you'd have a double-ended engine effectively, because you've got a cab at each end. But you've also got the power of all three engines working together to give a really nice powerful boost. So obviously, you know, it's really expandable in that sort of sense. And the fact that you could do ABA or ABBA or whatever form of that to get that double-ended locomotive kind of meant that turntables were redundant. Now, if I rewind back a bit, I said that diesels were set to replace steam locos, and the original intention for that was actually to use AB combinations. AB combinations were the same length as steam locomotives, so that they could still use the turntables, still use the roundhouses, and still use a lot of those features that were in place in the steam era, such as the sand towers, the water towers, and a few of the bits and pieces. So, for example, they could refill the radiators, refill the sand boxes using the steam era equipment. And the fact that they could use turntables made it easy, because you were essentially just replacing your steam loco with a diesel loco. So that meant obviously less maintenance, less time in the shop, less preventative maintenance as well, because a steam locomotive, after X amount of hours or X amount of miles, has to have a new boiler, has to have cylinders relined, has to have new tyres on the wheels, it has to have parts replaced, holes filled, boiler tubes repaired, especially if the plates buckling where they're held into, or one of the tube leaks, firebox stays have to be replaced. There's a whole list and a long list of things that can go wrong with the steam engine that railroad companies of that era were sort of going, this is extremely labour intensive, it's costing us a lot of money. And the other thing is, a steam locomotive after 8 hours won't, generally speaking, do much more without some maintenance. So obviously in that period of 8 hours, or however long the locomotive is, it's got to be fired up. That can take a couple of hours itself, just to get it up to a working temperature. During its use, you're then accumulating ash in the smoke box and soot in the smoke box. You've also got the ash pan as well for underneath the fire, so that as coal is burning, it then forms into like an ash, because it's been burned and forming into small elements. That is then caught by the ash pan underneath, so that will then get filled up as well. If you've got poor quality coal as well, you're generally speaking using more of it to get, because obviously it's probably a lower price to you, the drivers are then having to use more just to maintain that sort of level. So obviously the running of a steam locomotive by the time of the late 30s going into the 40s was getting extremely expensive, which is why they started moving to diesel power, and things like the GP units and the F units, and even moving in some railroads into electric traction to try and get away from the steam locos and all that sort of bump. So returning it back to the project, if you like, the A unit I thought was very nice, but you never saw an A unit, generally speaking, on its own. You always had an AB as a minimum, or an AA as minimum. So obviously I don't want an AA unit, or pair, because as nice as that is, it doesn't suit, if you like, why I wanted the sort of units combined. I wanted an AB unit because it's generally speaking the most common form it was delivered in. It's also one of the, you know, sort of like the standard thing to replace a steam loco. So that's what I went and designed, and that's what's on mock pages. But I didn't just leave it as a design and just have an A unit on its own. I've actually started building the B unit, and that Bricklink order from a couple of weeks ago was actually the purpose for making that order, because there's been a bit of discussion about saying that the F unit windows, the grey ones, were fairly cheap, and they're right, they're currently about €6 each. Now that is way down from the 10 plus euros they were even a couple of months ago, possibly even up to a year ago. So it was a really nice opportunity to just go in and snap them up. There was a really good seller on Bricklink who was selling them for fairly good money, and they also had the new, and I say this is new because I have checked and they're barely interested on them, the new decorative side frames for the motors. So obviously as a B unit, and I've designed it with two motor bogies, I needed four. So obviously there's a great cost involved in doing this A unit, because obviously the windows themselves were about €6 each, and the motor bogie side frames themselves were €9 each. Obviously I require six windows and nine motor sides, so obviously the cost of this loco, when it's going to be complete, is going to be quite substantial. And to be honest, I could build a lot more of the brick liner than I could do for this F unit, obviously because the parts parts are still current, you know, it's not an abandoned colour that Lego don't produce anymore, you know, etc, etc. But anyway, I've talked enough now about the theory and all that sort of stuff, let's now have a look at the real life model that I've currently been working on.
And here is the real life version of that very same LDD file that is available on mock pages. Now, as you can see, this B unit is not complete, but from a mechanical standpoint, this is fairly complete as an AB set. There are a few changes and things I need to point out. Obviously, the B one, there's lots of pieces in the wrong colour. Like a good portion of this grey is the newer dark bluish grey rather than the original stone grey, like on this, like on the A unit. There's still several things that I need to fix. The underframe, for example, there's only that one bit in grey. This isn't grey. This isn't in grey. Doors, all these vents are wrong. A lot of these vents, these sort of grill pieces, are actually in light bluish grey rather than the old light grey. These end pieces, the ends are wrong colour, and obviously I just need to fill this massive great roof section, which isn't complete. So obviously I said this is electrically complete, and obviously I can take the roof off. I've actually had to change the roof format with this little hollow here to fit the battery in the A unit. So for those wondering, this does have two batteries in it as well as a few other bits and pieces. So now as I've taken the roof off, I'm going to move the camera so you can take a better look at the inside. So obviously we've now moved to a top side view, and I've moved the units close to the table edge so the camera can see them. So in this A unit, it's not depicted, but there's actually a light unit in the nose. And that cable for that actually fed through underneath and joined the stomach cabling here. There's actually some extension cables plugged in here, so the light unit has one and the motor unit here has one, so the motor unit also comes through the other frame and then through. That's because the length of the cables isn't enough to get from the end of the B or real end of the B unit all the way up to the front end of the A unit or down into the underside properly, so they actually terminate the function elements, actually terminate here, and then also there's an extension element that takes it through the corridor connection. Instead of having two 1x2 bricks in there that are black for the corridor, for the doors, they're actually just 1x1s, leaving a 1x1x2 column gap that allows all three cables to pass through. So there's obviously the one from the battery, the one for the lights, other than the one for the motor underneath this rear section. Those wires feed this S-Brick Plus, I believe it is, as I haven't had the PFX brick delivered. So this has on it two power feeds at the bottom here, one from the battery in the B unit, one from the battery in the A unit. And there is actually a bit of a problem with that because I've had to use a 9-volt extension wire. And that actually only takes the function output of the battery rather than the power element. So I'm going to need to do some cable splicing, possibly a bit of re-engineering to ensure that the power from the battery in here actually goes through, because at the moment it's actually just using the function power instead. So it does still power both. Both batteries still do both power this S-Brick, but obviously that is a bit of a major issue because of that is outputting a lot higher than that is on its function output, even though that's turned to maximum. So obviously that's a bit of an issue. I have actually tested this, so this does work with both plugged in, just for those wondering. So this is a legitimate solution, that obviously this is only receiving something like 6.7 volts off there, but almost 9 volts off here, because this is obviously a bit more charged. So obviously that there's a dual power supply for this battery, for this S-Brick rather, from the batteries, and it actually has four functions. So as you may have guessed, we've already got one light and motor function from the A unit. We've also got two other functions which have already connected, and they're actually for the B unit. So there is actually three motors on this pair. We have the rear of the A unit, we have both bogies under the B unit. To make this a really powerful locomotive, and obviously with that power, it can pull quite, it should be able to pull quite powerful and quite heavy trains. So obviously there is still a lot of work to do. And the other thing is, of course, is that even though I've got the roof for this, I've not got the roof for this. And as many people will tell you, traction from a train doesn't just come from having much of power. It also comes from having quite a lot of weight, because obviously the weight pushing down on the wheels, on the between the wheels and the rail, make them compress a bit more and give you a bit more traction, because obviously there's a bit more weight to it, so it's actually having to force itself along, and it's actually gripping the track a lot better as well. Obviously, if you're trying to just do a unit on its own, making it as light as possible is actually better, because obviously then you're not having to drag as much with you. So obviously building it lighter using panel elements, for example, would be the best idea, but the here using bricks is actually fine, and it actually helps adhesion as well, to have more weight into it. One of the issues is that depending on where this S-Brick Plus goes, there is a bit of tightness in the cable. Obviously there's not from the A, but there is from B unit. So obviously this is actually slightly better off more towards this front here, but obviously you can't actually put this in properly because of all the cabling, so it needs a bit of attention in that sense to get that working properly. So this is controlled from Bluetooth, obviously, through the S-Brick Plus. So obviously I can turn the power on there and the power on there, and there's no indication whatsoever from either unit that there's a power issue, and there's this very attractive blue light that comes out the front of the S-Brick there. So this is a really nice play feature, to have all this power and all these function, all this power available to pull trains, and the functioning light element at the front. But obviously there's still quite a lot of work to do for the model, and quite a lot of, you know, attention needed, and to be honest a couple of bricklink orders just to complete this B unit, and maybe spruce up a bit more of the A unit, because I think there's still a few light bluish grey elements in there. So that's it for this update, and you know, hopefully when you next see the loco again, it'll be a bit further along than it is here. So yeah, that's it for this video, and I'm Matt, and hopefully you'll stay tuned for more channel coming to the content very soon.